very fortunate to have with us Kelly Joe Phelps, Ryko recording artist and slide blues guitarist. Today, Kelly will be giving a slide guitar demo for about half an hour. And Dave Alvin here will read some poems of his from his book, Any Rough Times Are Now Behind You. And Dave has read some of his poems on NPR, and his songs are fantastic. You'll get to hear full versions of those tonight at the concert at 7:30 in the Scharmann Theatre. Reading poems in the car? Okay. Sounds like quite a ride. Thank you very much. This is Kelly Joe Phelps, and then Dave Alvin.
How are you?
You
good? She's good. Anybody else good?
Yeah.
I'm nervous, huh? I'm nervous too.
Dave? Okay. No, I'm not so nervous. I'm just a little scattered. So I'm gonna play a little bit just for starters, so you can see what I do. That might, you know, help you if you have any questions. Help you see whether you have questions or not. Does that sound all right?
Yes.
Good. Hey man, you're late. Where the hell you been? Thank you.
Imagine them go. And so do you manage to
Train to carry my girl from town. Hey, you ruffians, out of here. Okay. So, anyway, here's what I do with the slide. Does anybody in here play the slide guitar at this point? Nobody? Kind of, sort of? Maybe bottleneck style? Maybe? Well, for starters, most of you don't know this stuff. Slide guitar is different from conventional guitar in that you're not holding any of the notes down. Usually if you hold the guitar this way, you're going to be pushing the strings against the fingerboard to make the note sound. But whether you're playing bottleneck style or in this case lap style, which I'll deal with more specifically in a second, whether you're doing, regardless which way you're doing it, The slide takes the place of your finger, and it also takes the place of your finger pressing the string down to the wood. So you can literally just put this thing down on the string, and it'll make the note sound. You don't have to press it down because of the weight of the bar. If you're doing it, sometimes you wear a slide on your finger, and just by pushing a little bit to get a solid contact on the string, the slide will act as a, you know, as the fret here. And you can slide to no side, though you don't really have to do that because you can also just play the notes like you would with your fingers. And that's the initial thing. The other particular problem with slide guitar playing is when you're playing conventionally, you just press the note down with your finger and then you pick the note and it sounds clearly if you press hard enough. But with the slide guitar, and again, whether it's bottleneck or lap style, if you just put the slide down and play the note, when you change from string to string, the notes that you already are playing with the slide are going to keep ringing, and that's usually the initial problem with playing slide guitars. You have to figure out how to keep notes from ringing that you don't want there, and that's just a matter of muting the strings. And with slide guitar, you mute the strings two different ways. Let me see if I can explain this enough that it makes sense. If I'm just playing on one string, on this top string here, there's really no muting that needs to be done. But if I want to do a melody and go from this string to that string, see, if I don't mute this string when I go to this string, you'll hear them both. I'll show you what I mean. And as soon as you get there, then it sounds like... Yeah? That's it. Who said that? So, in that case, what you need to do is either mute the string you don't want with this hand, you know, or you can do it with this hand somewhat too. With the lap style in particular, what I'm doing is I have the slide bar on the place on the string that I want, where the note is that I want. I haven't slept much, have I? So the slide bar is on the strings, and then, see these, I'm holding the slide with these three fingers, and these two aren't doing anything. And I use those to mute behind the slide. So if I get down low on here, this will keep these somehow inherent harmonics from coming in. I won't even worry about explaining because I don't understand it myself. but how did you do it? But in this case, if I go this string down to this string, if you watch, my middle finger is going to come down on this string and just stay there. And that way, none of the notes will sound, you see. Nothing happened. And I can pick that second string and move it around, and I won't get any extra notes. I did that flat on purpose too, by the way. It's a special technique I learned. I was in prison at the time. The other thing about playing slide guitar, that's kind of part of the initial approach is playing in open tunings. Now the guitar is tuned in a particular way, standard, what they call standard tuning, which if you have it tuned that way and you strum across the strings, it won't sound like any chord in particular. But in this case, I've got this tuned to a D chord, so if when I go across the string, it's already making music of a sort. You could sing to that. Easy, easy spy. And the advantage to using an open tuning is when you have a slide, whether it's a bottleneck slide or a slide bar is that way, then you put the slide across all the strings and you still have a chord, you know. Like that, all major chords in this case. And so that's why you want to use open tuning also, so that you can use the slide across all the strings and still get a chord out of it. Now from there, it gets a little bit trickier because, you know, once you get the hang of that, you're going to get real tired of just playing straight chords like that. So then you have to go to playing single notes, you know, playing melody notes, and then that's a matter of, like in any instrument, it's a matter of learning types of scales, major scales or blues scales or whatever. You could even do it with a regular guitar just by moving your finger around like that to find the notes. That's all that I do. And then you just add scales on top of that, scales on top of that. So that's where the years of playing come in. Anybody think of any questions that might have that help me get out of the pocket simmering on the back burner? Yes, sir.
Do you play just everything in D? Or like can you
hit
the key of D?
Right, yeah, that's a good question.
You told me it before.
Be healed. It's like you roll up in a wheelchair. I'll get him to stand up. He's walking. This guy's a ringer, you see. I'm sorry, what was the question? Yeah, so, okay, I have an open tuning and it's tuned to D. And there's two ways that I can play it in keys other than D. As far as playing solo, now there's two different ways that you'll see me playing. Actually, tonight there's two different ways you'll see me play. One is by myself, and then one is backing up Dave. And in the case of backing up Dave, I'm more concerned with playing melody lines. Like I'm not responsible for holding down the chords because Dave's doing that on his guitar. So if I'm only responsible for melody lines, I can pretty much play in any key with a tune like this, but that's only because I've taken the time to figure out where the scales are, you know. And it's just like I said, it's in, like any single note instrument, so if Dave's playing something in B-flat, and I know that's where my B-flat note is. Flat note again. So, but I can play any key that way. But if I'm playing by myself, then I'm more responsible for holding down bass lines and chords and the whole ball of wax like you saw me do. And that gets much harder in open tuning to play in various keys mainly because the less open strings you have to use, the more your slide is going to be responsible for, and the less extra stuff, you know, like in this case, playing in D, I can keep a rhythm going and play melodies on top of it. But if I'm playing in G, if I was going to play the key of G, the only thing, it's much harder to do that. I mean, I could go, position. It's less freedom. One thing that you can do, though, is instead of playing in the key of D, you can also play in the key of A, because you have an open bass note here, and there's also another A in the tuning. The tuning, by the way, if you're interested, is D, A, D, F sharp, A, D. So because I have two A notes, I can use that as my root, and also in the key of A, again, if you're familiar with this, there's a D chord that plays a pretty prominent part in the key of A, and of course I'm tuned in D, so I actually have two chords in that A, you know. Two keys I can play when it's open, when I play by myself. Uh-huh. Oh Lord, look what time is getting. What y'all having for dinner? Any of the questions you want to get to before we run out of time? Yeah. Late boy.
I was wondering, is it possible, like, say you have the guitar tuned to a major chord,
and a lot of that has to do with implying the harmonies, not so much because obviously if you have a major tuning, you know, like this is D and this would be a G chord, and this, I can't get a G minor chord because I don't have a minor third to get to with it, but I can play the minor tonalities if I keep some motion going. Like, let me give you an example of that. And even though, well, see, I don't know how much I want to say about that. What it takes is avoiding the major third, you know, leaving that out, and knowing where the minor thirds are in relation to the chord. So, like in this case, this note is what makes my tuning major. But if I don't play that, then you just have roots and fifths, and there's no tonality yet, and I can put the minor third in there, you know. So if you do have to figure out where it goes. Yeah, okay, and then when I go to G, I can still get to G minor, but it's always going to be a matter of avoiding that major third, and then you can bring the minor note in melodically. You can't really bring it in chordally unless you imply those.
Thank you.
can do it also with some kind of rhythm, like, let's see. So by implying the harmony, what I mean is that you use the minor third as part of any kind of melodic fragment, and it's going to make it sound like the whole chord is present. You know? There was a question way in the back there, a pretty green hat. I do. Do you?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, because the maybe because there's less preconception, right? You know what I mean? Like a word says too much. It's more precise, but it probably ends up being more individual as well. You know what I mean? Because the music thing is going to communicate on that level that there's no other way to get to, right? Yeah, I think that's it. Because even talking about it, you can see, is so much harder. Okay, that's a great question. Okay, one more question. I'll go get a cheeseburger. No, I don't use any other tunings. I keep this in D, and then I play also standard guitar in a different kind of C tuning. The reason I don't mess with different tunings is because, by and large, I'm an improviser. I don't work out parts of the songs or anything. And in order to improvise, you have to know where the notes are at. You know, that's the nice thing about instruments that have set notes, like a piano or a saxophone or whatever, you know what I mean? Could you play in different tunings, you mean?
I mean, there's a minor tuning and not the
same. Yeah, you could certainly do that.
It take a lot of time.
It would take as much time as any tuning. And the problem for me is that I like this tuning. I like having the roots on the bottom and everything. And I figured out how to make the thing sound minor. So there's not really, for me, for my approach, I mean, it's just not, it's not a necessity to tune to minor. You know, if I did, I could probably find some other sounds that I would like as well, but it's the more tunings that I mess with, the less freedom I have to create. If it's fast. Once in a great while, not too much. Yeah, those are good questions. Okay. This, I'll show you this last thing and then I'll get out of here so Dave can go on. This is my own little capo. This is another way to get out of the key of D. In this case, I'll put this up here. It goes under the strings, so the strings have something to rest on, and then clamp it over the top. Now, even though I'm in D tuning, I can play in G. Thank you.
Thank you all. Oh, you know what else? I have some records over here if anybody likes the way the guitar sounds. It's on this record.
Thanks a lot, Kelly. We do have CDs by Kelly and also by Dave Alvin over here. They're $15. Also, there are books from Dave Alvin. Any Rough Times Are Now Behind You. First time I heard these poems was on National Public Radio's Fresh Air program with Terry Gross. And Dave mentioned a professor of his called Gerald Lachlan from Long Beach State. And I never heard of Gerald Lachlan before, but he visited Jamestown last spring and I got to meet him and he read poems here. So we're fortunate here not only to have Dave Alvin's poetry teacher, but Dave Alvin himself. So thanks.
Oh, hello, poetry lovers. What I want to know, I have a question for you guys. Two questions, actually. What is toilet talk and why was it suspended? You know what I'm talking about? Does anybody know? What is it? What is it? I'm serious. I see signs everywhere. Toilet talk has been suspended due to some New York State law about the... Yeah, I know. He obviously does. I'm curious.
You missed the first one. If you weren't, didn't have, if you're born before January 1st, 1957, and you didn't have the right shots, you'd be suspended by whatever day. Something to do with immunization.
What they call the toilet talk?
It's like a flyer that goes through like every month or every.
Oh, okay, okay. I thought it was just like bad language. You know, I was trying to figure out why is toilet talk suspended, because it's going to lead you to possibly like have sex or something, then that's you know, bad for the immunization thing or something. I couldn't figure it out. Okay. The other thing I want to know is, who is Sarita Weeks? Do I remember? I know. Was she like the benefactor?
Yes.
Great. Well, I did a reading. Last year, they spent millions of dollars to build a new library in San Francisco. And when they built it, they started off with a year-long series of poetry readings. And they were nice enough to invite me, but then I set the record for the most obscenity said in the entire reading series. And that's why I was asking about Sarita Weeks, because I get the feeling that I don't know whether she'd approve or not. So maybe we'll read the ones that Sarita would approve of. This one, this is something that's not quite finished yet. This is from a book that'll be out next year. This is called Robert Johnson's Cigarette. Robert Johnson was murdered in 1938. He was a 27-year-old obscure blues singer, poisoned, they say, by a jealous husband. All he left behind were his songs and his voice on old 78 RPM records, describing a dark southern world of devils and hellhounds, violent men and lost souls, sweet women and lying lovers, redemption and damnation. A vision of America that America rarely acknowledged. His musical legacy and short life made him an influential legend and later a mystery and a myth. Now he's a postage stamp. No one except the old bluesmen who followed him in their youth knew what Robert Johnson looked like, until some blues scholar over 40 years after his death unearthed a torn and creased black and white photograph. He was young and handsome with long, slender fingers wrapped around the neck of his guitar. Oh man, page two has suddenly disappeared. He was young and handsome with long, slender fingers wrapped around the neck of his guitar. He stared out at the world without a smile, a fat hand-rolled cigarette dangling from his serious lips, with a look in his eyes as penetrating and wild as his voice. He looked like he might be a little drunk or a little high. He looked like he might be looking for a fight. He looked as unpredictable as a Saturday night in a Mississippi juke joint. And now that the old black and white and now, you really have to forgive me, I've only had about 4 hours sleep, so. Either that or I should just read the ones that are full of profanities. I know I could do that real well. She's a powerful presence on my back right now. And then we have this poor soul over here going, where were we? Oh yeah. He looked like he might be a little drunk or a little high. He looked like he might be looking for a fight. He looked as unpredictable as a Saturday night in a Mississippi juke joint. And now that old black and white photograph is a full color postage stamp. And that's a good thing. For too long, America, out of shame, ignorance, and maybe a cultural inferiority complex, has either forgotten or ignored or denigrated its powerful musical heritage and the musicians who created it. But now, John Coltrane, Jimmy Rogers, Hank Williams, Billie Holiday, Charlie Parker, Muddy Waters, Louis Armstrong, Howlin' Wolf, and even Robert Johnson are on postage stamps. Maybe it's too little, too late for some of these artists, but it's a start, and that's a good thing. The only thing that bothers me, though, is that someone or some committee in Washington, D.C. decided to remove Robert Johnson's cigarette from his postage stamp portrait. I'm positive that important meetings were held, hands were wrung, phone calls exchanged, memos and faxes sent, college-educated health and sociological experts consulted, and probably a study and a poll were commissioned, all because one day in 1936, a little-known Mississippi blues singer thought he'd look sharp in a photo with a cigarette in his mouth. I'm glad that some small steps are being taken against our country's traditional cultural elitism and racism, but I wonder if by removing Robert Johnson's cigarette, we aren't also trying to airbrush out our past so that it resembles our supposedly more enlightened age. Are we maybe trying to whitewash the harsh realities of 1936 America that his art was born out of, shaped by, and ultimately a defiant reaction to? He was a man of his time, place, and class, with all the expected human strengths and weaknesses. He smoked cigarettes, he ate red meat, he drank alcohol, he had numerous sexual partners, and they say several illegitimate children. He never settled down in one place with one woman, but was content to live his life, drifting from town to town, performance to performance, lover to lover. He probably loved his mother, but he may have hit his women, or his women may have hit him. But most importantly, he also created powerful art, writing songs, playing guitar, and singing with an intensity and originality that few have equaled since. I guess the postage stamps, like heroic monuments and statues and parks, are supposed to represent all that is good about us. So maybe I'm overreacting. Maybe Robert Johnson's cigarette doesn't mean anything. Maybe it's better not to glorify smoking or any other of our human frailties. But I'm more than just a little surprised they didn't want to airbrush a smile onto his face. That's called a... Oh, you don't have to applaud. You don't have to applaud. This isn't class. All right, let's give it to Sarita right where it counts. This is called Talking to Plants. This is about my neighborhood in Silver Lake in California. The easily offended, I will warn you now, might want to leave. Some other gentleman already taken this opportunity. I'm serious. This is a true story. I have a neighbor who... He's always up to something.
Hi.
Hi. Should we get a blanket to cover?
Is this one about the plants?
Yeah.
Oh boy.
Yeah, should
we go for it?
Well, you know, toilet talk has been suspended.
But it ain't toilet talk.
Nah, you're right. You might be right. When the book came out, I did a lot of readings at like Borders bookstores and places like that, you know, and
and they would set up these microphones and have PA systems, and so they'd have a little, like, you know, quaint little poet's corner, right? And but what they didn't tell me was they have the poetry readings aren't just in the little quaint poet's corner, it's blasted all over the store, so that when I chose what kind of material to read, I didn't realize that five-year-old kids in the children's section were going to be hearing these things. And I did one of the Borders in Dallas, and you've never seen a manager of a bookstore quite so willing to get into censorship. Maybe we should. It's not. Oh, it's not that. It's just Sarita did a lot of good work in her life, and why tarnish her memory and her benevolence by reading about my next door neighbor who has Tourette's syndrome? Okay. Well, maybe. Well, she was. I know that she. She was probably. She probably. I don't know. Well, I have a feeling that, looking at our gal there, world traveler.
She's got a sense of humor. Look at her.
She's got a smirk. She's been around. She looked like a martini kind of gal. Yeah. Well, we'll try this one on her, then we'll see. Somebody tells me when I go to bed tonight here in Jamestown that I will be visited. Mr. Alvin, I don't do things like that here. The worst part about going to poetry readings is always sitting and watching the guy or gal flip through their thing going, it's so freaking fascinating. Okay, this is, by the way, I have to say before I get into any more, I was trained, the professor who he mentioned, Joe Rockman, who came here and read, both he and another professor named Ellie Freed were great poetry teachers, and they taught me the creative writing classes were literally very strict classes that we had to learn how to write all the basic poetic forms, sonnets, blank verse, had to sort of get a decent mastery of iambic pentameter and all that. And when I started writing songs, which was right after I started writing poetry about a year or so, everything in that, all the traditional forms I used, and that's what I use when I write songs. But for the more that I made a living writing songs and more I explored meter and rhyming and all that, the more traditional poetic tools, the more and more my poetry began to resemble newspaper articles. And maybe I should just, I don't know, but that's explaining my poetic background here. Anyway, this is called After We Had Sex. After we had sex, after she left Virginia for Los Angeles, after she moved in with me, after we lived together for 2 years, after she asked every day if I still loved her, after I told her I did, after her first serious anxiety attack, after she wouldn't get a job, after I quit 2 bands, after I went into debt to keep my own band on the road, after a 300-pound guy wearing a purple negligee jumped in my car while I was waiting for her to come out of a store and kidnapped me at gunpoint saying, just drive and I won't kill you, after I said, please don't fucking kill me, after he threw the gun down when we saw a cop, after he and I fought for control of the wheel, after the cop arrested him, after I testified against the 300-pound man and he was sentenced to prison for 2 years, after I went broke and sold off my rare guitars, after I broke up my band, after she had more serious anxiety attacks, after she started seeing a therapist, after we started fighting every day, after we lived in 3 apartments, after we spent 4 days not saying a word to each other, after we stopped having sex, after I cheated on her once, after we started seeing a couples counselor, after an old lover died of AIDS, after we took the AIDS test, after we tested negative, after I spent 2 months living in Nashville, after I was dropped from my record label, after I caught meningitis, after I spent 2.5 weeks in 2 different hospitals, after I didn't get paid for a tour, I only did for the money, after her car was stolen, after she worked a succession of receptionist jobs, after she asked every day if I still loved her, after I lied to her every day, after she found a decent job downtown, after guys at her job started asking her out, after we decided there was no reason to stay together, after we looked for 3 months at apartments for her, after she finally found one she liked, after I paid her first and last month's rent plus the security deposit, after I moved her things into her new apartment, after I waited for the gas person, the phone person, the cable TV person, after I told her to call me if she ever needed anything, after she asked me if I still loved her, after I lied one last time, after I left her alone in a new apartment, after I ate dinner alone that night at a Chinese restaurant, after I opened my fortune cookie, my fortune read, "Any rough times are now behind you." This is one called "My Mother Fell." My mother fell this afternoon. My mother fell and hit her head on grandmother's jagged wooden table. Strips of her flaky skin clung to the table's sharp edge. I let go of her. I let go of her because she said she was cold. I left her standing alone in her walker as I went for her sweater, but the drugs or the chemotherapy had taken away her coordination, and she lost her balance in her walker, and she fell. I let go of her. My mother fell this afternoon like she was a baby, taking her first steps. The pink skin of her forehead quickly turned purple. A small slash of blood dripped into her half-closed eyes. My mother fell this afternoon, and my tears fell into her eyes as I tried to lift her back up. My mother fell this afternoon, my tears with her blood. My mother fell this afternoon. My mother fell. Oh, you don't have to applaud. People are so polite. We have another new one here. This is something that you never notice. You grow up watching TV, and it never really dawned on me that there's this whole industry, right, of people. Like you're watching TV, and a guy comes on saying, "Drink Budweiser, it's real good," or whatever he's pumping, right? And there are people out there in Hollywood that have big mansions on tops of hills because that's all they do for a living, is they just say, "Drive Cadillac, it's a good car," these people make a ton of money. And so stunning as it seems to me. So I got a phone call one day, and to come down because some guy liked my voice, and I had kind of images of maybe living on top of this mountain and just saying, "Budweiser is really good for a living. This is called cornflakes." "You must be Dave," she said. "Yeah," I said. "Well, the office is very excited about you, I must say. James says you're the only one he wants to do this." "Well, that's real nice of him," I said, not knowing who James was. "He told me that he wrote the script specifically with you and your voice in mind, and let me tell you, James is hot these days, and whatever James wants, he gets. That must make you feel real good, I bet." We were in a small recording studio in the San Fernando Valley. As we talked, she adjusted the volume and tone of my microphone. "You look familiar," she said. "You've done TVs or movies, I imagine." "Well, no, not really. A couple low budget things, but nothing you'd seen. I play music for a living." "No, I don't think that's it. I don't have much time for music anymore. You know how it is." "Yeah, I do, I guess." She handed me a one-page script with 7 lines, double-spaced. As I read the copy out loud, she smiled. "James is right again. You sound great. Let's get it down on tape, okay?" She silently counted down from 3 and then pointed to me. "It's a beautiful morning. The kids have finally left for school. You watch your husband drive away to work and you smile. The house is quiet. Now it's your time, your special time to relax with your favorite cup of coffee and a bowl of..." "What's the matter?" she said. "Nothing, I guess. Let's try it again." She rewound the tape and signaled me to go ahead. It's a beautiful morning. The kids have left for school. You watch your husband drive away to work, and you smile. The house is quiet. Now it's your time, your special time to relax with your favorite cup of coffee and a bowl of... Have you ever done this before? She asked. Well, no, I got a phone call from someone at your office, and, well, to be honest, the money sounded pretty. Yeah, well, I have an idea. Just say the name of the product. Cornflakes. Say it some more. Cornflakes, 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 cornflakes. That's very good, very close. But I need you to sell it to me. Make me want to buy some cornflakes. Cornflakes, 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 cornflakes. She turned on the tape machine. Now say it like cornflakes are the sexiest thing on earth. Cornflakes, 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 cornflakes. That'll be enough, she said. I'll just splice one of those onto the end of your second tape. That's it? I said, knowing my big money voiceover career was finished. Yeah, that's it. You know, we'll let you know. And good luck with that music thing. I didn't say anything as I walked out of the studio and into a reception area where there were six or seven young actor types and one old man who were waiting to audition to be me. Wrap up this little impromptu poetry beatnik thing here.
Why would you want to meet Nick?
I never care for Nick. He's always been a smart ass. Let's do one here. When I was one of my influences as a writer, both in poetry and in even in some ways in songs, was a guy named Charles Bukowski, and he was kind of the unacknowledged poet laureate of the bad side of Los Angeles, the side of Los Angeles that you don't see on TV and you don't see in movies. And if you do, it's always full of movie stars anyway, so. He died a couple years ago, and when he died, his widow had a small pressing done of people writing poems about him, kind of memorial poems, and she asked me to contribute something, so this is for Charles Bukowski. I once lived with a woman who owned doubles of every F. Scott Fitzgerald book. If you really loved me, she'd say, you'd burn your Bukowski books. Already in the name of love, I'd quit smoking in the bedroom, stopped talking to most of my close friends, and thrown away a small collection of porno magazines. But the Bukowski books was where I drew the line. No, I'd tell her, and sometimes that ended the discussion and sometimes it didn't. When it didn't, she'd harangue me with all the criticisms usually thrown at Bukowski, like a non-smoker preaching the evils of secondhand smoke. And I, like a smoker praising the joys of tobacco, tried to explain what it was like when I saw him read my first poetry reading in a small bar in Long Beach in the mid-1970s. I tried to explain what it was like seeing an old white guy as tough and cool as the old black bluesman I'd grown up seeing. How the bar was so crowded that all I could see above the drunks and hecklers, the English professors and the students, and all the young men pretending they'd seen and done all that old men had, was his head. His face scarred and unshaven, hair greasy and combed back, the kind of face you used to see on the old men in the old bars, on the old streets like Western, Atlantic, and Vermont. I tried to explain what it was like seeing a man who at the time when rock and roll meant nothing and everyone said, have a nice day, understood the silent madness of an empty room. A man who understood men, men like my father, men who passed out drunk at kitchen tables or on bathroom floors, who spit out chunks of their lungs while fumbling for another cigarette, men who felt so much they prayed to feel nothing. But I tried hardest to explain to her how I left the bar that night with words pounding in my skull for the first time like a good rock and roll song. His words, words like nothing I'd been taught in school, but had felt every day of my life. And I tried to tell her how from then on I wanted to write poems, songs, anything. And how, like the old bluesman gave me music, Bukowski gave me words. I never burned my Bukowski books, and I haven't seen the woman I've lived with in years. I guess I really didn't love her. You guys are great. Stick around for the show.
Kelly Joe Phelps.
Good evening, everybody. It's getting cold, huh? It's getting days from now, I'll be in Tennessee. I'll send you some. It's too early to get this cold, isn't it? Or does it always happen here? Yeah. Always?
It's common.
Wow.
Back and forth, then it finally just chills.
You must have coats.
Thick ones, heavy ones.
Ski boots. Ovaltine.
Hot cocoa and a fire.
Yeah, man. And a big old hairy dog is sitting next to you.
No, thank you.
If you want.
Oh, God.
I'm going to have to settle you all down. I mean, it's getting entirely out of hand. Well, I am Sam.
You am? Or you is?
Do you like them?
Yeah.
It's going to be before I fall out of my chair. But it hasn't happened yet, so my advice is bet against it. Well, it's great to be here in Ann Arbor. It's been a long time. So. Sorry about that. Oh, Agreed. That's called Sail to Jordan. That's the song that I have on a new record that came out about a month ago now. And they have some here somewhere in the back, I think next to the fruit and cheese. And you're certainly welcome to take it home. I'll trade you $15 or whatever they're charging for that. So, you ever spend a week on nothing but Jack Daniels and Tums? I can't seem to get off the pot, you know what I mean? I don't mean this. You know? It's hard work. Get a lot of calcium that way, you know. Seems like I drive okay. It's the DUI. What do they call it out here? Yeah. DWI? It's driving with inspiration. No, that's wrong. Don't do it. I'm kidding. I'm a jokester, you see. I'm paid to entertain.
It's driving while inspired.
No, man. Nobody drink and drive.
Oh, You now are going.
Thank you. That's also on the new record. That's the new record called Rumble the Storm. They have Mexican salami and cupcakes. Looking for that. Thank you.
I'll see you in my dream.
Thank you very much. That's it for me. I am Sam. I hope to see you again.
Now to welcome to our stage Dave Alvin from Downey, California.
Well, I guess you've all met Kelly Joe. We've done a couple of two or three of these kind of acoustic tours where he comes out and does his thing. Hi. Oh, good thinking. I'll stall. So we've done a couple of these. First thing I want to say is thanks to Craig Fishcorn for bringing us out here. He's the guy that decided that Jamestown needed to be in front of Joe. He teaches English here, and he's a great American, that's all I can say. Anyway, this is the, we've done a couple tours like this, like I was saying, the past year or so, Kelly Joe and I. But I have to say that coming out to play guitar after Kelly Joe is kind of like pulling up in your 73 Pinto next to a Rolls Royce going, oops. Yeah. I just got it washed. Those of you who ain't heard of me, which is probably the majority because I've never been around here before, my name's Dave Alvin. I'm from California and I write songs for a living. And I do want to say one thing. It is nice to be here because I play Buffalo and Syracuse and Rochester and those places. And I always drive by these towns up here in upstate New York, and it's so beautiful that it's finally nice to be able to stop and spend some time instead of just hit the gas station and the Coke machine, so it's nice being here.
Thank you.
Oh, you're more than welcome.
Good man's in prison, and a bad I've been covered in trash.
can tell, probably, if you're paying attention to lyrics, these are all really happy songs. See, normally I play with a band, and when I'm playing with my band, they're very loud, and I'm very loud, and you can't make out the lyrics, but you can dance to it. But then when I turn it down, it's like, oh my God, is he depressing or what?
See me.
quirky little number. Let's see. It's starting to get chilly outside, if, just in case you hadn't noticed. And one of the things, if you haven't been out to California at all, if you just watch daytime TV, you might get the stereotype that everybody's laying around in bathing suits with movie stars and martinis. And this next song is about when people either take their own initiative to cross over into this country. Sometimes they do it in an area where they think that everything, like I said, is just hunky-dory, and they come over in t-shirts and tennis shoes, and they cross over the border at the desert, and next thing you know, they wind up in a mountain range in the middle of winter. And this song is based on what happened last winter when it was very, very wet and cold in California. It's a true story.
Thank you. Well, sitting alone, thinking of a girl he swore he'd wait with for. He's drinking beers and he's feeling old, remembering every lie he's told, till he changes his mind and he leaves. Save your baby. sake of my baby. I'll forsake my fine, fine home.
Thank you.
choices you made on the old racetrack you made. Have all the money to buy anything you like, but I don't care how big you are. I don't care what you're worth. See, when it all comes down, you got to go back.
Thank you.
I smoke a cigarette alone. Mexican kids are shooting fireworks for love. She kissed me in cheek when I want her lips, and I don't have the strength to go. On a lost side of town, in a dark and poor man. So long ago, on the stairs I smoke a cigarette alone. Mexican kids are shooting fireworks for love. Hey man, it's the 4th of July. Dry your tears and maybe walk outside. It's the 4th of because I have to tune for about 5 minutes. also, this is a song I wrote one day. And a little while after I wrote it, it was recorded by a guy named Dwight Yoakam. So when we play it, I just wanted you guys to make sure you're not like listening to a cover band at a line dance and denim and diamonds kind of nightclub here. I have to do that because sometimes when you play, people call and say, you do any other Dwight songs? Another sad one.
I'm aching heart.
over my head. Sometimes I sing away the sorrow. Yeah, baby, you know. One time I took it like a man. Thank you.
first one. Thank you all very much. Good night.